She is amazing. I've known her for a while. She's actually in the book. You'll see her on there in the middle of the two gentlemen on that cover of the Tag Talks book. And she has a powerful story. Like I said, I've known her for a couple of years, and I don't even want to touch on what she's going to talk about because it's strong. You don't want to hear it. So welcome, Whitnie Wiley.
Changes everything. It changes your relationships, changes your perspective, the way you see life. If you're paying any attention, it changes you, whether for a minute or a lifetime. Now, I was no stranger to death, lost members of my family. In a less literal sense, I endured the death of a marriage and deaths of dreams. But I wasn't prepared for the event that happened on June 26, 2005. On my way home, we were on our way home. My son, who had graduated high school, on our way home from his graduation ceremony, and he fell asleep at the wheel of his car. And the car careened off the road into a grove of eucalyptus trees. My son and one of his passengers did not survive their injuries that day. That Sunday started like lots of other Sundays. I got up. I did my morning routine, something people who are into personal development often have as a part of their lives. I got up, I prayer, Bible study, journaling. And we were preparing for his graduation ceremony. So my son, so he got in trouble with the criminal justice system. He ended up getting expelled from school, not just suspended, but expelled. And of course it created lots of tension. I just wanted him to graduate from high school and move on with his life. So I enrolled him in an online program out of Southern California. And they had a graduation weekend, which I thought was really cool, right? You go to an online school and you never get to see the people that you go to school with. And so they had a prom. And then they had the graduation ceremony. And so we caravaned. My sister drove one car. I rode with her and her son. My parents went as well. And then my son invited his girlfriend, his best friend, and his best friend's girlfriend. And they drove in the other car. You go down, have a great weekend. Graduation ceremony is great. We pack up to head home, and in pretty short order, tragedy. So we're driving up the coast. If you've ever been along the coast near Santa Barbara, we're just past Santa Barbara, and I look behind, and the car is not there. I'm calling. No one answers the phone. I keep calling, no one answers the phone. Eventually, my sister gets off the freeway. We turn around and head back up 101 or down 101 back towards Santa Barbara. and I see my son's best friend, Isaac, standing on the road covered in blood, trying to wave down traffic. And no one would stop for him. We finally pass, get to an exit, and able to come back around. When we finally get to the scene, the passenger who also did not survive the crash was on the ground. Isaac was trying to give her CPR. She died at the scene. Life Flight came, jaws of life, extracted my son from the car, took him to hospital in Santa Barbara. We followed behind. And a couple of hours later, sitting in a hospital waiting room, the doctors come in and say, there's nothing more we can do for him. And in that moment, my world came crashing down. But you know, it's not what happens to us. It's how we handle what happens to us that matters. And I had a choice. In that moment, in the days and weeks that followed, in the years since, to make a decision. Do I let that define me? Or do I take what I've been through and use it to be a better person, ultimately to be a better leader? The choice, I hope, is obvious. I'm here. I'm working every day to use the things that I learned in the aftermath of that accident and that experience to grow, to give, to learn, love, and to serve. So I spent a lot of time in the weeks following asking questions, pondering the meaning of life. Not so much asking why me, why him, why us, but what am I supposed to do with this? How do I move past the pain? How do I grow into the person that this experience has the potential to make? Some things you need to know about me before the accident is that I would be someone you would consider a pretty logical and analytical person. Wasn't heart-centered at all. I wasn't someone who was vulnerable or open, really, to deep emotions. I liked anyway. There are people that I liked, some that I actually loved. But I hadn't gotten in touch with who I was as a person. I hadn't gotten in touch with the softer side of Whitnie. And this experience forced me, I would say kicking and screaming, forced me to allow people into my world. Let me give an example of something really simple. If you consider yourself a strong person, and ladies, I'm going to share this with you or ask this of you. Do you feel like you're supposed to have all the answers, right? You're supposed to do it right. You're supposed to be able to take care of the kids, take care of your job, take care of your spouse if you have one. You're supposed to balance all these things, juggle all these balls, and do it perfectly. And then when you don't, what do? You beat yourself up. We don't ask for help. And I found myself, for the first time, being in a place where I needed help. The first thing that someone did for me, and my inclination was to say no, was to have someone offer to send maids to the house, knowing that people would be coming to the house for the memorial service and whatnot. And so a colleague of mine, a friend of mine, offered to send maid to the house. And before I could say no, she's like, I'm not taking no for an answer. And I just said, thank you. It wasn't my nature to accept help. It wasn't my nature to ask for help. I had spent my time being the person that people come to. I'd been that person my whole life. I'd taken my analytical side, my logical side, and made them available to people as a problem solver. This was a problem I couldn't solve. Motherhood, I will say, started to change me. But not completely, right? But it was in stages. So I became a mother. The person of, you know, who I was had to be someone who put someone else first. And as a leader, I had not been, up until that point, someone who had done more than be in leadership positions for anything other, quite frankly, than myself. Either I thought I could do it better than whoever else was in charge. It was for padding my resume. It was for my own ego. It was not about the people that I served. It wasn't about the team. And the point of what I want to share with you here today is that through this experience, as I became a better person, I ultimately became a better leader. I recognized that leadership wasn't about me. Went to law school. And at the time, my priority was my son. When I started law school, my son was 8 years old. I was a single mother, had been through a divorce. It was not a pretty divorce. And I did everything I could to try to prove to myself, to the world, anyone who would listen, anyone who was watching, the statistics that I wasn't going to be one of them. I was determined not to be a single mother statistic. So when my son wasn't with me, I had joint custody with my ex-husband at the time. And when my son wasn't with me, it was me in school. I joined almost every club, every activity. I did moot court. I was on the law review. If there was something to do, I did it in my continuing effort to prove I was worthy. But it wasn't for the people that I was leaving. And it was only in the aftermath of my son's death when I was struggling. What's the point of all of this? Why am I here? What are we doing? How can I turn this around? And I stopped and really listened for the first time in my life to what I call this still small voice of God's wisdom. Now, I'd had an encounter with God before this accident, and if you read the TED Talks book, you can get the story of that there. I'm not going to share it here today. But because of that incident, and I believe in divine timing, that incident put me on a path that prepared me for surviving and thriving through this experience of death. I had an incident that an experience that I do want to share with you. Sort of funny. It is one of the things that I learned about leadership, right? It's not about telling people what to do. It's not about dragging people. It's about relationship. It's about give and take. It's about a little pushing, a little pulling, right? It's a dance. It's relationship. So one Friday afternoon, we're coming home from school. Theron and I, we're coming home from school. And if there are any parents in the room, you'll recognize this, particularly if you are a parent of a teenager. You pick your kid up, you say, hi, how was your day? And the answer is fine or hi, right? And that was my son. He'd say hi. And then I spend the next, you know, trying to drag answers out of him. This Friday, for whatever reason, I just decided to say hi, ask him how he was doing, and then shut up. And what do you think happened? He talked the whole way home. hour and a half, stop and go traffic from Vallejo to Sacramento, right? On Friday evening, if you've ever been on 80, he did not stop talking the entire time. But there was a lesson for me in that. And the point of all of this is, it is the experiences of our lives that guide us, that answer the questions that we have. That if we would just take the time to listen, will send us in the direction we need to go. So what I learned sort of over the course of these years are six factors about leadership that have helped to move me in a direction personally and professionally that have made all the difference for me. I call it simple because in my world, everything is simple. Not necessarily easy, but simple. And simple is an acronym. The S is for self-awareness. And I spent a lot of time alone in those early days. Thinking, praying, sitting, listening, avoiding people. Thinking about who I was, trying to figure the whole thing out. And then that told me and informed the things that came after. I paid attention to the need to be intentional, which is the I in simple, to be intentional. It's intentionality. It's our determination to be in the moment, to make a decision and move in a particular direction with the thought that that's where I'm supposed to go. The M is for mastery, but it's not just mastering a subject. It's not just learning what leadership is or learning who you are. It's about taking what you learn, the things that you are mastering, and putting it to use. The P is for purposefulness. When you think about your role as a leader, so here's my philosophy about leadership. I am Jesuit trained in leadership. I have a bachelor's and a master's in organizational behavior development and leadership. One of each. We're all leaders, right? We're leaders every day. You're a leader whether you have a title or not, whether you lead a group or an organization or not. You're a leader as a parent, as a big sister, maybe as a younger brother, right? Baseball teams, whatever. We're leaders every day, and we're leaders not in a vacuum. We're leaders because there are people who are watching us, following us. Whether your followership is as large as you want or not, you are a leader, and there are people listening and watching. The L is for leverage. So, what do you leverage in your role as a leader? As you've thought about what your purpose is as a leader, your purpose is, at least in my opinion, is to lift people up, is to empower them, it's to give them what they need in order to become leaders themselves, better leaders, right? And this leverage is about taking the experiences of your life, the things that you've learned, the tools, the resources, taking those and using them for the betterment of those you lead, if it's an actual team, for the team. And then energy. We're all energy. Our thoughts, our emotions, are either energy itself or guided by it. And if your energy changes the energy of other people, what do you think that should be? You can walk into a room. I had a boss who was very much, at least in my humble opinion, not a leader. And his continuing mantra was, I have an open door policy. I don't understand why people don't come in and talk with me. Because, sir, when people come in, you bring the room down, right? That's not your role as a leader. We should be lifting people up. We should be leaving them better than they were when we encountered them. And so, if you take these six components of simple and you embrace them as a pathway for you to be better, starting with the self-awareness, because without self-awareness, the other five don't matter. The way you impact people, influence them, which is the essence of leadership, influence, not kicking and screaming, not throwing your weight around, but influence. You understand whether or not you are bringing that to the table, the other five follow along pretty easily. And so I shared the story of my son's death because that experience changed me. It opened my eyes to where I was falling short, to my seeing the world as only about me. A little bit about my son, right? But it was about me and how I was going to be, you know, the next this, that, or the other thing. And ultimately, I learned that this life, short life, not about me. It's not about you, right? It's not about the leader. It's about those we lead. It's about those we have an opportunity to impact. And when we embrace that, when you take to heart the lessons that I've learned, that I'm sharing with you, you take that to heart, you become a better person, a better leader. And ultimately, the leader that even you would follow. Thank you.